Hey, what are they gonna say? So we're gonna leave out the story. I love this, and I can't find this. the thing is about this story is it's got a bit of a language, and the language is kind of integral to the story, so you can't really cut it out. So if you have little ones, or you are easily offended, sir, you might want to sneak out, like maybe 3 pages into the story, right around the time it gets good. this is how I'll let you know that it's time to leave. I'll do this. This is from Dancing Barefoot. It is excerpted from a story called The Saga of SpongeBob Basements.
SpongeBob.
I first met William Shatner on the set of Star Trek V back in 1988. I was 16 and had been working on Next Generation for 2 years at the time. We were enjoying some success with our show, and I was very proud of the work I was doing. When I found out that the original series cast would be working next door to us for 2 months, I was beside myself. Gene Roddenberry was still heavily involved in the production of TNG back then, and he and I were good friends. When I passed by his door, it was not uncommon for him to throw an executive out of his office and ask me in for a visit. He knew that I was a fan of the original series, and he knew that I was more than a little intimidated by these actors. He offered several times to make introductions, but I always declined. If I was going to meet these legends of science fiction, I was going to do it on my own. For weeks, I tried to get up the nerve to introduce myself. When I would walk from the stage to my dressing room in the schoolroom, I would do it slowly, looking at their stage door, hoping to catch a glimpse of Mr. Spock, Dr. McCoy, or even the legendary Captain Kirk. The few times they did appear, though, I could never find the courage to approach them. This went on for about 6 weeks. Word got around our set that I was too chicken to introduce myself to the original series actors. It became something of a joke. And the crew began to give me some good-natured ribbing about my reluctance. Next Generation was immensely popular at the time, and I was still riding high on the success of Standing. They couldn't understand why I was so intimidated by these actors. My face was splashed across the cover of every teen magazine in print. Well, why was I so intimidated? Who was a 16-year-old geek with a chance to meet the big three from Star Trek. The math equation is not that complicated. One afternoon while I was sitting outside stage 9 talking with Mandy, my costumer, they opened the huge stage doors across the way, and I could see right into the set of Star Trek V. It was a large area, like a cargo bay, filled with extras and equipment. It was quite different from our set, but it was unmistakably the Enterprise. Standing in the middle of it all, William Shatner. He held a script open like it was a holy text. The way he gestured with his hands, I could tell that he was setting up a shot and discussing it with the camera crew. I waited for the familiar rush of nerves, but it didn't come. Seeing him as a director and not as Captain Kirk, the way it is, I knew that this was my moment. If I didn't walk over and introduce myself right then, I was wearing the gray acting ensign space suit, which I call the Iron Maiden, unzipped with the sleeves tied around my waist. That costume was really uncomfortable, so I'd take the top half off whenever I got the chance. Because it was a jumpsuit, I would tie the sleeves around my waist and wear a lightweight fleece jacket zipped up to cover the embarrassing fake muscle suit the producers made me wear. We all wore those muscle suits, even Michael Dorn. But I think I was the most traumatized by it. I've always been a very slight person without very much muscle mass, and having to wear all that thick, uncomfortable padding did little to improve my fragile teenage self-esteem. I turned to Mandy and took off my fleece. I asked her to zip up my spacesuit and fasten the collar. I was going to meet William Shatner. I was going to do a little Starfleet regulation. She made sure. sure my costume looked good enough for camera and wished me luck. I got a high five from one of the Teamsters as I confidently walked across the street and into the cargo bay of the Enterprise 1701A. It took about 8 steps for my confidence to evaporate. Surrounded by extras in Starfleet dress, standing next to a shuttlecraft, William Shatner, director, was immediately transformed to Captain Kirk with the Galactic Legends. I was transformed from Wil Wheaton, fellow actor and film industry professional, into Wil Wheaton, drooling fanboy and Star Trek geek. I looked around. I guess I blended in well because nobody had noticed me. I turned to make my escape and bumped into a skilled photographer who had worked on Next Generation in the first season. Okay, Will, what are you doing here? I swallowed and looked at the stage door. I just came over to look around. Stuff. I shuffled my feet and began to move back toward the familiarity of my own spaceship. Well, as long as you're here, you should meet Mr. Shatner. Mr. Shatner. Who's Mr. Shatner? He turned toward Captain Kirk. He called out, "Hey, Bill, come here a second." My heart began to beat rapidly as he turned toward us. Captain Kirk looked right at me. I froze. He gave his book to someone, and I began to walk in our direction. I involuntarily straightened my back and sucked in my stomach. My muscle suit felt tight and marked his chest. In seconds, he was standing next to us. He was about my height, looked a little heavier than he did on television. Captain James T. Kirk, the Starship Enterprise, said, "What can I do for you?" "Well, Bill, this is Wil Wheaton. It's part of the cast of the Next Generation, and we'd like to meet you." Captain Kirk looked at me for a long time. "So, have a kid on that show?"
Introduction. He vanished.
unzipped her back, she said, "Did you get to meet William Shatner?" "Yeah," I said. I didn't want to let on when I was upset. "What's wrong?" she asked. She handed me my first jacket. "Well," I hesitated. Saying it out loud would make it real. "He was a dick to me." Her eyes widened and she gasped. "What? Why? What happened?" I fought back tears and recounted our introduction. "What an asshole!" Shrugged my shoulders and walked back to my trailer where I sat down and cried. I had spent weeks getting up the courage to meet this man, and in less than 5 minutes he had insulted and humiliated me. He had reduced me from peer to peer. I had worn my costume thinking that it would matter to him, but he made fun of it. 15 minutes later, an assistant director knocked on my door and told me that they were ready for me on the set. I stood up, wiped off my face, and told him that I'd need to make a quick stop in the makeup trailer on my way. He told me to hurry. I walked to the makeup trailer, taking great pains to look at the sky, the ground, the walls, anything that would keep my head turned away from the Star Trek V stage. I sat in a chair with my makeup artist, Janet, and he came to touch me up. "So I heard about Shatner to you." I wish I could finish this story, but I'm totally out of time, so it's in.